that we need to know so that we can keep you safe and we can put fires out, right? So one little neat thing about fire, or I'm sorry, about water that I wanted to show you before we get started. So I put this can into the freezer. The neat thing about water is it is you really can't compress it, right? It is what it is. You can speed it up, make it move faster, get your pressure up, but you can't compress it. But what's really exciting about it is when it freezes, it expands. In this case, you see it actually ripped this can open. So the neat thing about water is it's got its principles, right? When we talk about pressures, we're going to talk about how fast it moves. When we talk about volume, we talk about how much water. So let's go over to the whiteboard, and we'll get right into this, okay? We're going to do some math. Ready? Algebra. Look at that. So we're trying some new technology today. So if this thing shudders and comes to a stop, and you see me like this for a couple seconds, hang in there. We'll get it back up, okay? So just realize this new technology. If I freeze frame, it's us, not you, okay? So stay with us. Now, when we talk about water, water comes from, in our case, it comes from an aquifer. It's underneath the ground. Huge, trillion gallons of water, just massive amount of water that flows underneath our feet in the Spokane Valley. What we do is we use pumps to bring the water up, and two things happen there. Either A, we put it into a tower, and we'll talk about why that happens, or B, it actually goes right into some pipes in the ground, like this. Giant pipes in the ground that send water to your home. It also sends water to fire hydrants. And yes, this is actually a real hydrant from probably the 1930s. I actually bought this out from a guy out in the West Plains. It was part of an old system and I had to cut it out of the ground. It was epic. You should have seen it. But I like this kind of stuff. I actually have a hydrant collection. So if you have an old hydrant at home, you're going to be like the fire science guy. They're really heavy. Nobody can steal them. It's awesome. Now, so we use plastic pipe or PVC today. We also use ductile iron. Back in the old days, they used wood. This is really cool. I'm going to bring it a little closer because you have to see this. This actually came from the intersection of Pines and Sprague. This is a 6-inch wood fire main. And that little thing on the end is a brass water spigot. Water came from this into people's houses and they drank it. We also used to be able to dig holes in the ground, find these mains, drill holes in it, and then hook up to the water. That's why they call them fire plugs. That's hydrants, fire plugs, because they used to drill holes in water mains and then plug them when they were done. Anyway, that's a little bit about the history of water, how it comes in the ground, right? What we want to talk about is a lot of cool stuff. We're going to talk about the pumps on the fire truck, because water by itself isn't the most critical thing. Water by itself isn't enough. We need to put it in a hose and so it shoots. That takes pressure. And for that, we have stuff like this. This is an actual fire pump made by Watrous that is in fire trucks that we drive. This is a two-stage pump. Let me show you what that means. I don't know if we can zoom in on this a little bit. So we have two settings on our fire trucks. We have lots of water. We have lots of pressure. What this means, this is heavy. That's a lot of water. This is fast, right? Water's moving fast. So the way this works, if we have a really, really big fire and we need lots of water, we put the trunk into volume mode, right? Lots of water, heavy. The way it works is, this right here, this hooks up to the hydrant, and that's this area right here, and it brings water into the pump. And inside the pump, there are two of these things. They're called impellers. Kind of looks like a boat, right? It actually takes the water. Water comes into this section here. You see all the little fins? And as this spins on the end, you see there's angles. It actually throws the water out into the hoses. Sometimes these get damaged. This one came from our shop. It came from a fire truck that we actually had. I don't know if you can see it, but there's a rock right there in that. So the rock got sucked into the water and broke everything inside there. So it's not a big deal when that happens. Well, let me rephrase that. It is a big deal when that happens, but we always send more than one fire truck to a fire. So just in case it happens, we got another truck there. We're kind of like the Boy Scouts. We believe in being prepared, okay? So this model right here, the way this sits is, where I'm standing would be the front of the fire truck. And when we go, I'm right here. The front of the fire truck is where I'm standing. And this is the back of the fire truck over here. We're going to go to a clip that we filmed yesterday, and it's going to show where all the hose is. This is where all the hose in the bed of the truck's going to be. So water comes in through the side ports here, and it goes into this two-stage pump. Ah. Now, you saw, I showed you the one separately. That's how it sits inside the truck. So we got two pumps, or two impellers, right? And so when the water comes into the truck, when it's in volume mode, water's split in two, and it goes into each impeller. So it spins, each one of them together. So that moves a lot of water, twice the water, right? And then it goes out to where the hoses are. When we want pressure, what happens is there's some valves in here. I really hope you can see this. When you turn, in this case, let me show you the valve. This guy right here, it's got a hole all the way through it, right? So this fits into the pump up like this. And when you turn a lever, it closes off one of those holes. So this is the process where you close that off. We want lots of water, fast water, so we actually turn that valve and it blocks the intake. So water can't go in here anymore. So then it comes into this impeller. Then what happens is there's another port that's open, and then the water goes back into the second one. So it spins the first one, building up speed. It goes into the second one, spins some more, and then it discharges really, really fast. Typically, when we're flowing water with a fire hose, at the end where the water's coming out, we want there to be 100 pounds of pressure, PSI, right? This is important because if we have less, the hose kinks and the water doesn't flow as far, and we don't get as much water as we want. So it's really important, and you'll see all this when we go outside and see the demonstration, right? We also need to know about how much water we have. Most fire engines in our department have 500 gallons of water. Now, 500 gallons of water, does it sound like a lot? It really doesn't to me. Consider this. The average bathtub in the United States is 60 inches by 30 inches. That means it holds about 80 gallons of water. So 500 gallons of water is about 5 bathtubs. That's what we carry on the truck. When we look at our hose, we've got different sizes of hose. So let's take a look over here. 5-inch, that's our supply hose. You'll see it when we go outside. 3-inch, we can use it for supply, but we also use it to hook up a monitor. It's really cool. You'll see it. 2.5-inch, we use that by hand. And then 1¾-inch, that's our most used hose because it's easy for us to move around. What I like to do is figure out how much water we have in each one of these hoses, right? So let's go over here to this side of the board just real quick. It's time to do some math. Come on. In order to figure out volume means how much stuff fits in there, right? Let me show you an example of volume. This is 1 gallon of water. That's volume, right? So we're going to do the math for a 5-inch hose. The 5-inch hose, obviously it's 5 inches, right? It's also 100 feet long. So 100 feet. In order to use this formula to figure out how much water's in there, the first thing we got to do is we got to make sure that our unit of measurement's the same. So we have to get 5-inch and 100 feet. So that's not the same, right? We got to get them the same. So we go 5-inch, and then we go 12 inches per foot times 100, 12,000 inches. So a 5-inch hose, which is this right here. So we're going to have 12. I think it's 1,200, not 12,000. What are you thinking? Come on. 1,200 versus 5 inches right here, right? So now we're the same. We look at our formula, volume, which is what we're looking for, that V, right? We got to have pi. Pi is located here. It's also right there. It's 3.14. This is actually has to do with the radius of a circle, right? This is a constant number that they use. It never changes when you talk about volume or surface area of a circle. So that's always a set thing. So we always know that one. R squared. What does R stand for? I wrote it down. Radius. Now, when we talk about radius, radius is half the diameter of the circle. The circle itself is 5 inches. We need half of that. So half of that is 2.5, right? 2.5. Length, we know that's inches, 1,200. And when we do the math, this is how it works. We're going to use this formula here. It's 3.14. We're going to go times. We're going to put a parenthesis here. 2.5 times 2.5. Right? And then the last thing we're going to do is we're going to multiply that by 1,200. So when we do all this math, we figure all this stuff out, we come up with a number. That number is 23,550. That's how many cubic inches of water is in one section of 5-inch hose. What does that mean, cubic inches? We're not done, right? We have to actually go into the medium that we want. We wanted gallons, right? So now we figure out that there are 231 cubic inches in every gallon. Now it's a little bit of math. Now we got to take that number and divide it, right? We got to figure out how many cubic inches, how many gallons are in that 23,000, right? So if we did the math real quick, here's how it works down. There is, in this section of hose, we're going to go like this. Ready for this? There is 101.9 U.S. gallons in every 100 feet of that hose. So if we have 500 feet in a fire truck, 500 gallons of water in a fire truck, and we lay out this 5-inch hose and we fill it up, we go from 500 to 400. That's just to fill the hose up. And we know that this is important for us because we have a very limited amount of water at first. And so we have to think about, okay, well, how much water does each of our hoses carry, right? Let's go over here and we'll do a breakdown for you. So the 5-inch, we already did the math, right? I showed you how that works. We've got 101.9 gallons. Now, on the 3-inch hose, if we take the numbers that we used here and use those formulas, we could figure that stuff out. Part of me wants you to do that at home. But part of me wants to show off and put it on the board too. So I don't know what to do. I'm torn. Okay, I'm going to give you one more, right? One more. Let's do the 3-inch hose, because that one I want you to understand, because we actually hooked that up out there in such a big hose that I want to make sure you understand a couple things about the volume. So in a section of 3-inch hose, which is only 50 feet, by the way, we use more of it. Typically, we use two sections at least, right? And so in a 50-foot section of that hose, is a whopping 18.3 gallons of water. So if we have two of them, 18 plus 18, 36, right? 0.3, so it's 36.6 gallons of water. If we have four, see how this multiplies, right? The more hose we have, the more water we use just filling up the hose, and that's not good. So we want to park as close as we can to the house, being safe. We want to make sure we bring the right kind of hose off to fight the fire. And then we need to make sure that we get that hydrant hooked up with our big 5-inch line so that we can actually continue using water. So all this stuff is something that we train to do every day. Not every day, but we do a lot, right? We train a lot for that stuff. And we do that so that we can work really quick because water goes fast. Typically, and in the video you'll see, we're going to flow water at certain rates. One case, we're flowing over 400 gallons in every minute from one hose. So what I'd like to do right now is we're gonna go send you off to the lot or to the pre-recorded session where we were outside where I got all wet. Stick around, we're gonna come back here, we're gonna talk some more. We'll see you in a few minutes.
On there, we'll flow.
Okay, hey, so we talked about a whole bunch of really cool stuff inside, right? We talked about the pump, I showed you how it works. Now we're actually gonna show you how it all works for real. We're gonna actually put water in gear. So the very first thing, when the fire engine gets there, some things have to happen. Building's on fire, so the plan starts instantly when we stop at the end of the street. Put the brake on, we make sure we drop it into pump, which is this lever here, and we push drive here. When we jump out of the truck, firefighter and the officer are going to be going out doing stuff. The engineer comes over here, and before anything happens, safety first, we're going to put the chocks down, right? The chocks go down, the pump's engaged, and then he goes to the panel. He's going to look at his gauges. He's going to see what's coming into the tank. He's going to see what's going out. He's going to use hoses on these trucks right here, cross lays, and we've got some hoses out. We're going to show you how this works, but all this stuff is used in fighting fires. These things a firefighter can grab, drag out, and put water on a fire, and our goal is to do that in less than a minute. So all this stuff is all controlled right here. And we talk about water pressure and volume.
like we talked in the classroom, this is again trying to put all that classroom stuff into practical use. Let me show you where we get the water from. So this is the other side of the truck. This is a 5-inch hose. We call it the supply line. Great big hose, lots of water. Every corner, well, not every corner, but a lot of corners in the city that we live in and protect has hydrants just like this one. Anytime we have a fire of any size, we always hook up to this because it's going to flow a lot of water. Sometimes over 1,000 gallons a minute. This hydrant right here will easily give us that. And now look at this. It's so full of water and so crazy that it's tons of pressure, right? So if we open this here, bring it all the way open. Now all that water from the hydrant is coming through this valve right into that pump that I showed you in the building, right? All that water going right to the pump. Okay, we just showed you the hydrant where the water's coming from. This pump intake shows that that hydrant there has 50 PSI or pounds per square inch. We talked about that in the classroom. That's what we're looking at here. That's what we can use at the fire scene. All right. Okay. So here's the deal, folks. Last episode, we talked about water. We talked about how it's wet, it works, it puts out fires, but I also talked about super water. Every fire truck the Valley Fire Department buys has something like this. This right here interjects foam into our water. Breaks up that surface tension, absorbs the material that's burning. So every truck's gonna have that. Once we engage the pump, which is running right now, we wanna make sure that there's water in it. So we have an electric primer. It spins and makes sure that we've got water in the pump. Hear that noise? Once that loud noise goes away, we know that there's water in the pump. So right now, our pump pressure is 100 PSI, right about there. Our intake's 50. That tells us how much water we can use. In these two cases right here, we have two lines hooked up. One is 1 3/4. We talked about that in the classroom, how much water's in there. The other one's 2.5 inch. Take a look at this gauge here. This gauge goes to this one right here. When I pull this lever out, pressure here becomes 100 because it's all part of the system, right? 100 PSI here. I'm sorry, 80 PSI. Now if I pull this second one, the 2.5, same thing's gonna happen. Here we go. Wet job. So you take that and cover it up like that, water stops spraying, right? So, we're going to raise the pressure up. Each one of these hoses has a certain amount of friction loss. This right here, we're looking at least 10 pounds, probably 12 pounds per section. This one right here, we're looking at 7, 7.5 to 8 pounds. So we're going to bring the pressure up. We want it at 100 PSI at the nozzle. Pressure up here, the pressure's up to 100, we're going to add a little bit. Now we're going to fill water. Okay, so we got an 1 3/4 line and a 2.5 inch line. These are the two most common that we use at a fire scene. I'm going to show you how far this will throw 150 gallons. That's probably more than your bathtub holds. Let's see if we can hit the Ford pickup. What do you say? Not bad, it's almost there. We're probably 6 feet away. Now we got a lot of water coming. You gotta love it when the wind changes on you. Now we're gonna go with a 2.5 inch. This is gonna be 250 gallons to 300 gallons a minute, depending on the type of nozzle that we have. We're gonna try to hit that pickup from here. I think we can get it. Again, the pressure's gonna be 100 PSI because that's what we want that fog nozzle to be at. See the way this bends down more? Lots more pressure. I think we got it. I think we hit the turn. It needed a wash anyway. So you can see lots of water being thrown a long ways. That distance right there, easily 100 feet. So that's the kind of thing that we carry on the truck, and all that has to be orchestrated by the engineer. All the pressures and everything, very critical that we get them right, because it's dangerous if we don't. Those are really hard to hold on to, even for our trained firefighters in good shape. So making sure it's right at the pump is gonna help us do our job. So you gotta love the guys that run the pumps. They're good people. We just showed you the two most common lines that we use, right? The 1¾-inch and the 2-inch line. This right here is a 3-inch line. We use it for supply to bring water like the 5-inch we showed you earlier. We also use it for this thing behind me called the Blitz Fire. This right here is a portable master stream. It's for putting a lot of water onto something that's burning bad. As a matter of fact, every one of these little nozzles tells us how much it will actually shoot at what PSI. We run these at 80 PSI today. We're gonna shoot 80 PSI. So if I shoot this one right here, it'll be 415 gallons a minute. But we're gonna use the big one, because why wouldn't you, right? So let's go see if we can get some water out of that thing, make some music. Ready? Okay, I'm probably not going to aim for the Ford pickup with this one, because it's going to be a lot of water and I don't want to break anything. What we're going to do is we're going to show you how this works at a scene. Ready? Now, once we get it open, so right here, what we did is I set it up in an automatic mode. Well, let's say we have some big, large propane tank or a big, large fire, and we want to put the water from one side to the other. All we have to do is push a button, and it automatically does the sweeping for us. So right now, we can leave this alone and let it do its job. Lots of water here, big stream. You can see how much we're flowing? All right, so I was just told by the engineer, 444 gallons a minute is coming out of that nozzle right now. About 3 of your bathtubs, my guess. Lots and lots of water. So that's something that we'll use on those big fires, right? It's a nice little tool to have in the toolbox. We've got something bigger than that, though. Okay, so here's the deal. I told you we have something bigger up on top of the truck. I don't know if you can see the truck, but that right there is the deck gun. This gentleman over here is controlling the deck gun with a remote control. We can turn it left, turn it right, we can bring it up, bring it down, putting water on the red stuff. That's our job, right? In this case, we're flowing a lot of water. You can see over here, the thing will actually turn left and right all by itself. Can I look over this way a little bit? The deck gun just moves back and forth. Go ahead and give me a sweep to the left, boss. Look at the wheels turn all by themselves. Now, in case this thing breaks, we can get up there and do all that by ourselves, by hand. Well, since the remote's working, we might as well use that today, right? So again, we have lots of different ways to get water on the red stuff. In this case, has a deck gun, lots of water, and it shoots an incredibly far distance. You're not going to get over cones on this end. You're really going to get this involved here. Give me a cone or two. See if you can hit a cone, buddy. Oh, no. Cool, stop. Lots of water. Can you get the cone? Are we too far away? Bluetooth? There we go, he got it. So it's all about the fine tuning, right? This is for big fires, so if we get close, it's close enough. It's kind of like hand grenades and horseshoes. Close is close enough. All right, perfect. So here's the deal. We just did a bunch of stuff with a fire truck and we hooked to a hydrant. On both sides of the truck, there's a 5-inch hose that we can use to hook to the hydrant. This one, if like say we park next to a house and there's a hydrant on this side of the truck, we just use this. If we park and the hydrant's on the other side, we use the other hose. So it gives us options. So we always carry a lot of extra hose. In this case, we have these two hookups, and in the back of the truck, we have 1,000 feet of it. We should show you that. Let's do that. Okay, I don't know where I'm at in the camera frame, so I'm gonna do this real quick. So, I showed you the fire hydrant. I showed you the big yellow hose, right? That's our supply line. Here's 1,000 feet of it. In the city, every hydrant, there's supposed to be hydrants every 600 feet. So we got more than enough. Even in those places where the hydrant coverage isn't that good. We've got another big stack of hose here. This is our 3-inch. That's for that monitor that we showed you, or that's for supply as well, and then 2.5. Here's something you probably didn't know. In the street, or maybe you did, in the streets of Spokane and Spokane Valley, there's huge pipe like this. This is what the water comes in to the fire hydrants. Speaking of fire hydrants, I'm gonna show you how we test them. Okay, so I just showed you this great big pipe. I just showed you all the hose in the truck. Hydrants are fed by pipes like these in the ground, right? This one right here, probably 8-inch, maybe 10-inch. Lots of different sizes. Most of them are gonna be 4-inch or bigger. What we do is we put a gauge on one end of the hydrant and we put what we call a diffuser or a diverter on the other side. This takes the water from the hydrant and throws it away for us. In the valley, there's over 5,400 fire hydrants. That's Spokane Valley, Liberty Lake, Otis Orchards, and Millwood. 5,400. We test every single hydrant every year. We do two types of tests. We do a pressure test where we look at the gauge. In this case, it's 58 PSI. And then on half of them, we actually flow so we know how much water is there. We're gonna do that real quick, okay? So I've got my gauge on, I've got my pressure all hooked up. I open this valve here, and we're gonna shoot water out there. We're gonna let it run for a little bit because underneath the ground, there's all this water moving this pipe. It takes a while for it to get going in one direction. As you can see, the water's going over 50 feet away. Great big amount of water. Let's see what our pressure is. We're at 40 PSI, so we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 800 to 1,000 gallons a minute coming out of this hydrant right now. Once we get both pressures, make sure that we shut it down nice and slow. Remember I talked about all that water moving? It's hard to stop. And if you stop it too fast, you get something called water hammer. Water hits and everything shakes. You don't want that to happen. So everything gets shut off nice and slow. Nice and easy, we shut it down. It's getting quiet again. We can start relaxing. All right, hold on a second, ladies and gentlemen. But I want a couple things. First one is, these things aren't to be played with, right? We need these to work when we need them, right? Has to work. We go out and test them to make sure they work. What I want you to understand is the colors are there for a reason. In the county, we want the hydrants to be yellow. In the city of Spokane, they're red and silver. If they're private hydrants, they're red. Don't paint them, okay? I actually went to a lady's house one time because she painted it to match the trim on her house. I went to another house where they painted it to look like a Dalmatian. I went to another house where they painted it green so it didn't stick out so bad. They're meant to be yellow. We need to be able to see them. Please, please, please do not paint these hydrants, okay? Another thing, we're gonna be out testing this year. You can say hi to us. We want you to come up and say hello. Make sure we do the whole COVID-19 thing, right? If you see us flowing water, don't drive your car through it if you're old enough to drive, because sometimes rocks fly out of here. I'll show you a rock later on, or we showed you a rock earlier, right, in the impeller. Another thing, don't run through the water. Again, rocks fly out of this stuff sometimes. I explained it all earlier so you know why the rocks are there. I'm just reminding you. We'll see you inside. Okay, so.
Hey, about time you came back. So what'd you think, right? So we went out there yesterday and filmed a lot of stuff, which was really good because we had a bunch of helpers, right? So thanks to Engine 9 for coming out and doing all that great stuff. Thanks for the people filming all this stuff last minute. So this is all kind of experimental stuff. Hopefully it works pretty well and we keep doing this kind of thing. While you're outside, we talked about hydrants a little bit. So I wanted to come back in here. We showed you how we tested one, right? So this is some of the gear that we use, right? So there's a lot of really cool stuff out there. This guy right here has a big device in the middle. What I showed you out there was a deflector. It moves water in one direction. What this is called is a diffuser. Oh, look at that. See, I'm new, right? New to this whole thing. We're going to show you how to test a hydrant. That's what I meant to say. Which is really going to be cool.
Okay, so I just showed you this great big pipe. I just showed you all the hose in the truck. Hydrants are fed by pipes like these in the ground, right? This one right here, probably 8-inch, maybe 10-inch. Lots of different sizes. Most of them are going to be 4-inch or bigger. What we do is we put a gauge on one end of the hydrant, and we put what we call a diffuser or a diverter on the other side. This takes the water from the hydrant and throws it away for us. In the valley, there's over 5,400 fire hydrants. That's Spokane Valley, Liberty Lake, Otis Orchards, and Millwood. 5,400. We test every single hydrant. Every single hydrant every year. We do two types of tests. We do a pressure test where we look at the gauge. In this case, it's 58 PSI. And then on half of them, we actually flow so we know how much water is there. We're gonna do that real quick, okay? So I've got my gauge on, I've got my pressure all hooked up. I open this valve here, and we're gonna shoot water out there. We're gonna let it run for a little bit because underneath the ground, there's all this water moving through this pipe. It takes a while for it to get going in one direction. As you can see, the water's going over 50 feet away. Great big amount of water. Let's see what our pressure is. We're at 40 PSI. So we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 800 to 1,000 gallons a minute coming out of this hydrant right now. Once we get both pressures, we make sure that we shut it down nice and slow. Remember I talked about all that water moving? It's hard to stop. And if you stop it too fast, you get something called water hammer. Water hits and everything shakes. You don't want that to happen. So everything gets shut off nice and slow. Nice and easy, we shut it down. Getting quiet again. We can start relaxing. All right, hold on a second, ladies and gentlemen. But I want a couple things. First one is, these things aren't to be played with, right? We need these to work when we need them, right? Has to work. We go out and test them to make sure they work. What I want you to understand is, the colors are there for a reason. In the county, we want the hydrants to be yellow. In the city of Spokane, they're red and silver. If they're private hydrants, they're red. Don't paint them, okay? I actually went to a lady's house one time because she painted it to match the trim on her house. I went to another house where they painted it to look like a Dalmatian. I went to another house where they painted it green so it didn't stick out so bad. They're meant to be yellow. We need to be able to see them. Please, please, please do not paint these hydrants, okay? Another thing, we're gonna be out testing this year. You can say hi to us. We want you to come up and say hello. Make sure we do the whole COVID-19 thing, right? If you see us flowing water, don't drive your car through it if you're old enough to drive, because sometimes rocks fly out of here. I'll show you a rock later on, or we showed you a rock earlier, right, in the impeller. Another thing, don't run through the water. Again, rocks fly out of this stuff sometimes. I explained it all earlier so you know why the rocks are there. I'm just reminding you. We'll see you inside.
All right, so you saw how the fire truck runs. You saw how the water flows out of the fire truck. You saw how the hydrant works, right? We also showed you how we tested hydrants. Again, like I said, we test hydrants all over the valley every year. A couple different tools, right? I showed you what we called a deflector, right? What this does is it sends the water in different directions so we don't ruin your yard, right? We also use something like this. This is called a diffuser. And the difference between the two is the deflector is just the pipe that moves the water in a direction. This actually moves the water in a direction. And there's this big bell in the middle of it right here, this big circle. The water hits that and it breaks it up. So instead of a huge stream of water, 2.5 inches wide, taking out a house, it breaks it up and it doesn't throw the water as far. So we've got lots of different tools in our toolbox. Last episode, someone asked a question about hydrants and they saw a red cap on a hydrant that was yellow. So in some jurisdictions, they decided they wanted to lock the hydrants up because people were using the water illegally. Hydrants are expensive. They cost a lot to maintain. In order to fix them, sometimes you got to dig them out of the ground. Well, if they're asphalt or concrete, that's the problem, right? So they want to put locks on them to keep them safe. So this is an example of a lock. Lock would go through that eye right there. We come up, we got a tool, we break the lock, take this part off, and there's the cap that we use. So this all comes off. Now, important to understand, I want you to understand this, we know they're out there, and we are prepared to unlock these. So it's not a big deal for us. We can get into them. But what we want to do is make sure they don't get used by someone else that isn't trained how to use them. So these are two examples of a lock, and what they do is they sit right on here. When we need it, we cut the lock, and we go to work, right? So don't mess with these things. Just know that they're out there, and they're there to keep the hydrant safe so we can use it, right? Now, in the video, I also talked about water hammer. What does that mean exactly? It ain't carrying a hammer around. What I mean by that is water weighs 8.34 pounds per gallon. We showed you that there's 102 gallons, I'm gonna round up a little bit, 102 gallons in that one section of 5-inch hose. So that breaks down to 840 pounds-ish. So when you have 840 pounds moving in one direction, imagine a freight train going down the tracks. It's not easy to stop that, right? So water hammer is the same kind of concept. It's not easy to stop the water. And if we shut the water off too fast, we create water hammer. And what that can do is break things. So during the break, when you guys were watching the pre-recorded stuff, I thought of an idea. I wanted to show you what water hammer is. I don't know if this is going to work. I don't know if we're going to have a gallon of water on the ground. I don't know what's going to happen. Gallon of water, cap, we turn it upside down, and the water, the cap is strong enough to hold on. But if we shake this just a little bit to get all that water, which is, this is probably about 7.5 pounds, if we get that 7.5 pounds to hit this right here, it should open up. Let's see what we got. It's not working. So we're going to just do a little adjustment here. See if we can work it now. Okay, we're good. So the water actually hits that and breaks the cap off, and then the water flushes out, right? So that's what water hammer is. If we misuse this equipment, we can actually break things. So we're familiar with water hammer. We understand the concept. We get that there's a freight train moving underground. We showed you what 5 inches of hose will carry. Now imagine if it's a 12-inch water line. Do the math there. So take your formula. Volume equals pi r squared times length. So say 100 feet of 12-inch pipe. Do the math, send it to me, because I don't want to do the math right now, okay? My head hurts. Okay, so that's what I'm talking about, right? And the way we get our gauges, right? The gauges, I showed you the gauge out there. What I wanted to show you is a close-up of the gauge. So this right here goes from 0 psi all the way up to 160 psi. So we're talking about how much water is flowing and how fast it's moving. This is a really fancy tool. It's called a pedo gauge. And the way this works is, pretend this is our hydrant. Water's shooting out of it. We take this gauge here, and we hold it into the stream of water. And the gauge will tell us 0 to 200 PSI. That PSI is important because that tells us how much water we can use. It's not just about how much water, but it's also about how fast it's going. That's going to give us the opportunity to keep you guys safe when it comes to putting out fires. So lots of different stuff going on out there. We got a lot of crazy things. What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to go over to the next table, and we're going to talk about a little closing thing, okay? So let's go over there real quick. All right. So I promised you guys we were going to do a little experiment with a microwave. If you remember last week, it didn't work out so well because the guy that set it up put it on a GFI breaker, or not, I'm sorry, put it on a breaker, right? And the breaker kept tripping. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this rag, just like we were going to do last time. We're going to place it in the microwave. Now, if you didn't see last week's show, the reason why we did this experiment, we did it, actually we showed KXLY years ago. We had a fire in a house. The gentleman that was living there said that he went to a doctor. They said, put a towel in the microwave when it's wet, put it on your shoulder. That warmth will help ease the pain. So he did all that, but when he took it out of the microwave, it smelled funny, so he put it on the back deck. Didn't think anything of it. But inside, like a burrito that's too hot, it was burning inside that towel. And then when I did the research, I found out there was actually a lady in Wenatchee that actually died by doing this. She's an elderly lady. She was told to put a hot compress on. When she undid the towel, It burst into flames. And the only reason we know that's exactly what happened is because the paramedic that was there had the smarts to ask the question, what happened? So when I did this test, it was because we had two fires within 8 hours that started the exact same way. And when I found out how important it was, you know, because this lady lost her life, I wanted to make sure everybody heard the story. So we did a story with news, and we're going to run this real quick. I should have been running it while I was talking. So we're going to turn this on. 3 minutes. We're going to see what happens. Now, while that's going, firefighter Rick Fryer was actually doing some home improvements at home. And I found something that was kind of interesting. I'm up in my attic. I'm going to replace some of my recessed lights. Let me show you what I found. So back in the old days, 60s, 70s, 80s, they had light fixtures like this that would sit inside your roof, your ceiling, right? And they'd show light down below. It's called a recessed light. They weren't supposed to be buried with insulation. When I got up there, I found this one buried insulation. And if you look at the wire, it's actually starting to fall apart. We talked about the process of pyrolysis in one of the first episodes, right? Talked about how fire needs that fuel to change from a solid to a gas. This was doing that very thing. Inside, luckily, I had fiberglass insulation. It doesn't burn, it changes, but it doesn't really support combustion. So the good news was, I had to replace the insulation, I had to cut this wire out. If it would have been a different kind of insulation, I might have had a problem in my house. So important to recognize these things as problems if you're gonna be doing your home improvement by yourself and realize you gotta fix these problems. The good news is, I didn't burn down my house. The really good news is I didn't do this. This is what it was like when it was built in 68. So just again, realize electricity can be a problem. If we cover up stuff that we're not supposed to, like an extension cord, it can cause a problem. Electricity is our friend, but we got to use it the right way. All right, so let's take a look and see where our burrito is. Temperature, right? How much time we got? We've been in there almost 2 minutes now. We're going to go at the two-minute mark. We'll take it out. We'll take a look. Okay, I think we got a little smoke going. We might have done a really good job here. We're going to drop it into this fish tank and close the lid if it's too smoky, okay? Here we go. So right now, I've got it at 280 degrees on the exterior of it. Take this guy, and I unfurl it. Oh, look at this, ladies and gentlemen. Look at that. You see that right there? We started on fire. That was only 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Let's see what the temperature is. 349 degrees is the hot spot right there. 2 minutes, and it's really, really smoky. Listen, the moral of the story is microwaves are really cool, but when you put something in there, you gotta make sure you know what you're doing. It's supposed to be for food, right? If you're gonna heat up a rag, I recommend that you maybe get some hot water in a pot, maybe boil the water and then put the rag in the water, but don't put the rag in the microwave, okay? There's other ways to get that rag warm. Don't put the rags in the microwave, really, really bad. Listen, we tried some new stuff. Hopefully it worked out really well for you. If it didn't, I'm sorry. Please come back. We're gonna be on YouTube Live. We're gonna be on Facebook Live. If you haven't taken the time to friend request us, fix that. Please. I'm doing all this work. I need something out of it, right? You guys are awesome. We'll see you next week.